Good morning, students. So today we'll be continuing with the third stanza of the poem An Elementary School Classroom in a Slum. So we talked about first stanza where the children, they have been depicted as being very miserable. Okay, their condition is pathetic. So these children are being called as being unlucky. Why unlucky? The particular child who has been called as being unlucky because of the fact like he has inherited the disease from his father, the disease of bones. He's got twisted bones. So because of twisted bones, he is deformed. He has stopped growing. It's not that only one child is unlucky. The fact is that all these children who are born in slum and are forced or doomed to live in slum forever, they are all unlucky. But yes, their luck can be changed, their fortune can be changed if they are evacuated from the slums and brought to the kind of place which is befitting for a human being. Second stanza is about the classroom. And if the physical condition of children is miserable, then the kind of classroom they've been given to study, that is even more miserable, that is even more pathetic. Because whatever the kind of classroom it is not suitable to provide learning atmosphere to the children. Whatever is in the classroom, it is for the namesake. It is not to supplement children's learning, it is only to suppress their learning. So second stanza talks about the classroom, which is a pathetic place for the children to study. The fact is, the reason is that there is nothing which is required for these children for elementary level. The things which have been kept in the class, they are for namesake. Maybe it is the landscape, maybe it is Shakespeare's picture, or maybe it is the map. All these things are irrelevant because for these children, their world is the slum. Unless they are taken out of slum and given the ideal atmosphere to live, all these things are irrelevant. They have no relevance for these children. And now the third stanza, we were at the mid of the third stanza. The poet, we had done even first, second and third line, but still I can explain them in nutshell. So the poet is like now explaining like why is Shakespeare irrelevant in the class? Because Shakespeare actually is the one who stands for higher studies. Shakespeare is the one who can be understood only by the ones who have reached the apex of education. Okay, those who have been able to understand various nuances of literature, only they can understand Shakespeare. These children who have not been taught the fundamentals of language, how will they appreciate Shakespeare? So Shakespeare is definitely wicked for them. Shakespeare is definitely irrelevant for these children because Shakespeare is the one who talked about ships, sun and love in his works. So his plays, which are all about ships carrying lots of merchandise and all, sun with, you know, all knowledge, wisdom and love. Love being the main theme in the Shakespeare's plays. So Shakespeare, who is known for riches, knowledge and love, that Shakespeare is definitely irrelevant for these children because these children have not been able to have an access to love, riches, or even knowledge. Right? Why love? I'm saying because nobody loves them. Had somebody been there to love them, then these children would not have been in slum. They would have been living in very, very good conditions. Had these children been rich, then also slum might not have been there. Had these children been knowledgeable, had somebody poured upon them knowledge, even then these children might not have been here. So these children have nothing to do with knowledge, love, or riches. Ships are symbolic of riches. Map a bad example, and even map is not required for these children, because in the end these children are living in this slum, and this slum is their world, and they won't be able to identify or relate themselves with the globe, because that slum is not there in the globe. For lives that slyly turn in their cramped holes. So why is map a bad example? Because they are born and brought up in the suffocating hutments of the slums, where they keep growing up as the clever souls, as the clever ones, the ones like the kind of child we read in the first stanza with rat's eyes. So the child with rat's eyes is the one who is growing up slyly, the one who is growing up to be a clever being, the one who is growing up to be a criminal. The one with hunger in stomach is always in search of grabbing something or the other, as per the chance would come. So these children in these suffocating, cramped hutments are growing up to be the clever criminals. They are growing up to be the clever souls. And we have already got this kind of cleverness in the child of first stanza, where the writer poet was saying that a paper seeming boy with rat's eyes. So the child with rat's eyes is the same as the one which is slyly turning in the cramped holes. Got it? From fog to endless night. So these children who are growing up to be clever criminals, in their dark hutments, for them, is that map of any relevance? No, that is of no relevance. So these children, their future is painted from fog to endless nights. So giving them this kind of education with this kind of, paraphernalia in the class, it is like making their future, which was already bleak, future which was already foggy, it is like turning that unclear future into totally dark future. This is a very important expression of the poem. So what I mean to say, in the first stanza, the last line was that their future is painted with a fog. See that line. So their future is painted with a fog. Where their future is painted with a fog. What is that place? What is where? The slum, the cramped holes. So they grow up in the cramped holes or in that suffocating place where their future is totally foggy, unclear. And you teach them in this kind of classroom, then their future will be totally dark. Earlier it was unclear, but if you teach them like this, then their future will be totally dark. So already their future was not at all bright. But with this kind of atmosphere in the classrooms, you are going to definitely kill their future. Okay, they won't have any future. They will simply turn to be criminals. So from fog to endless nights. So will this map have any relevance where their future is being painted with darkness? So the classrooms which are shaping their future with darkness, does that classroom have any relevance with that kind of map or Shakespeare? This is the end of this expression. The poet simply want to say that the kind of classroom where their future is being turned to darkness, that classroom is the one where they have kept Shakespeare or globe or landscapes. With those kinds of things, their future is definitely going to be dark. Dark means no future. if there is something dark, it means that it has nothing. There is no prospects of growing up or progressing. So wear skins. So on their slag heap, these children wear skins peeped through by bones and spectacles of steel with mended glass, like bottle bits and stones. So here is a description of the children, those who are living in the slum area. What kind of life these children are leading? When we imagine a child or children, we imagine playing them happily. That is what comes to our mind. But when you look at these children in the slum, then you will find these children living on garbage. These children living on the waste out of waste, slag. Slag heap is a heap of waste. Not the waste from where you can have something useful, as you people read in the stolen childhood. There, that boy, you know, Sahib-e Alam, was able to have something out of the garbage. But here, these children are living on the heap of the garbage, which is totally waste. So they live on the heaps of waste. And these children wear skins peeped through by bones. How can they wear the skins when they are themselves skeletons? So these children are nothing but skeletons. They are so thin. So these children wear skins peeped through by bones means these children are bony. They are totally skeletons. They have no flesh on their skins. They are so malnutritioned. They are so weak that bones peep through their skins. It seems that the bones are looking out of their skins. So can the bones see through the skin? No. So here it is a poetic device of personification. So when the bones seem to be looking out of the skin as if they were the eyes. So actually the expression is that the children are malnutritioned, they are very weak, and they are altogether a skeleton. And they wear spectacles of steel with mended glass. And moreover, they've got weak eyesight. Having poor eyesight means poor future. What are your eyes symbolic of? Eyes are symbolic of vision. And vision is what you can see for your future. So these children have poor eyesight, that is poor future. That is symbolic. But if we talk about this line literally, so these children have poor eyesight because of malnutrition. So, and they wear the glasses of repaired glass. They've got the spectacles, not brand new spectacles, but they might have picked up those spectacles which have been discarded by somebody. So they are wearing broken spectacles. What kind of vision will you have with broken spectacles? What kind of vision will you have broken spectacles? Blurred. Blurred. If you can't even have a proper vision, what kind of life will you live? So these children live a dismal life with life which is dependent upon the heaps of garbage, with life which has, with the spectacles which are repaired many a times. These children wear skins peeped through by bones and spectacles of steel. Spectacles of steel, alliteration is there. Sir sound. With spectacles of steel with mended glass. Like bottle bits on stones. So they are wearing the spectacles which are broken. The glass of those glass spectacles is broken. And those spectacles look like the bits of bottle on stones. So the way when you break a bottle on stone and its bits are, you know, disseminated or scattered all over, in the similar way, their spectacles look like broken pieces. So like bottle bits on stone is a, what kind of poetic device? Simile. So here their spectacles have been compared to the bottle bits on stone. The word like is there, so it is a simile. All of their time and space are foggy slum. So all their time and space. So all the time and space are foggy slum. So throughout their life, they live in the in this foggy slum. Why foggy slum? How can the slum be foggy? Where their future is unclear. So they spend their whole life and time in the slum where they don't have a good or bright future. All their time and space are foggy slum. So whole life is spent in the slum where there is no bright future. Look at the line. So blot their maps with slums as big as tombs. So blot their maps with slums as big as tombs. So remove their maps. So the maps which they have. If you try to remove those slums from the maps, these slums are like the big dooms. So what these slums are? These slums are as big as doom. Doom is death actually. So these slums are nothing but the death traps of these people. These slums are the graveyards, tombs, where they are buried while being alive. When is a person put in the grave? After death. Yes, beta, listen. When is a person put in the grave? After death. And the slum is equal to a graveyard. And these children are being made to, are buried inside this grave while being alive. Okay, living in slum is like living in slum means like being buried alive. Living in slum means like being like buried alive. Because slums are as big as doom. Doom is death. So these slums are the death traps. And these children are being shoveled into that death trap by we kind of people. So let us remove the maps. Let us remove these slum areas from the maps of the world. Let their world not be the slum. Let their world be the world which is beautiful, the one which is shown to them through the landscapes. Let us take them to that beautiful world. So second stanza is about the miserable life these children live in the slum, and the poet almost ends up the idea, like finishes off, concludes the point that life in slum is equivalent to life in graveyard. What one does in the graveyard, these people are doing it while being alive. So as big as doom is again a simile. Okay. Unless governor, inspector, visitor, this map becomes their window, and these windows that shut upon their lives like catacombs. So the poet says, like, unless governor and inspector and visitor. Who are the governors, inspector and visitors? Authorities. Okay, unless and until the authorities come and do something for these poor people, this map becomes their window, and these windows that shut upon their lives like catacombs. So unless and until the authorities come and do something for these people, so that this map become their window, not the slum. From the window, these children can see otherwise a slum. But what should be our mission? Our mission should be that they can see their world in the slum. Sorry, in the map. So let them see their world in the map. And their world should not be the world of slum, but the actual world. Look at the line, very important. So unless the authorities come, what cannot happen? Unless somebody takes responsibility, these children will not have the access to the vast world. These children will not be able to break the shackles of the slum which has kept them inside like a graveyard that shut upon their lives like catacombs. Catacombs are graves. What are catacombs? Graves. that shut upon their lives like catacombs. What shut upon their lives like graveyard? Slums. The slums enclose them like grave. So unless some authority, unless somebody takes a responsibility, these people cannot be taken out of the slum, which is a graveyard for these people. What's the meaning of first, second, and third line? Unless somebody takes a responsibility, these people will not be able to come out of the slum, which is a graveyard, which has seized them inside it, which has buried them alive. That shut upon their lives like catacombs. So like catacombs is again a simile. So that shut upon their lives. What is shutting upon their lives like catacombs? Slum. So slum is like catacombs. Slum is like catacombs. So it's a, beta, look at the book. Be attentive. So what is like catacombs? Slums. Slums are like catacombs. Catacombs means graves, graveyards. So how can you say that the slums are catacombs? Because slums are like the deathbeds, graves. In the grave, you are put after death. But in the slum, they are kept when they are alive. So their condition is as if they have been buried alive. Zindagi inko dafna diya. It is like that. So these places, slums, are the suffocating places. The poet says this in the previous lines. So these are the cramped holes, because they are like the graveyards. And these are the graveyards where they have been buried alive. So the poet says, like, somebody has to take the responsibility. Who that somebody is? It can be the governor, it can be the inspector, it can be the visitor, any one of us. Somebody has to take the responsibility to take these people out of their deathbed. Break open till they break the town and show the children to green fields and make their world run azure on run gold sands. So let them break the town. Let them break the barriers of confinement. What is breaking? Let them have the chance to expose themselves to the world. Let them have the chance to explore the world. Break open till they break the town. So let them run. Give them the freedom to explore the world on their own. Let them have the opportunity to come out of their prison. What prison? Slums. The life in the slum is like a prison. Life in the slum is like a life in the graveyard. So let them come out of their cramped holes till they break the town and show the children to green fields and let them explore the green fields. See the lines, very important. And show the children to green fields. Let these children explore green fields and make their world run azure on gold sands. Let them run on green fields or let them run on the deserts. What is gold sand? Somewhere where there is sand and sand. So let them run bare feet upon the golden sands and make their world run azure on gold sands and let their tongues run naked into books and let them read. First, let them explore green world or the world of deserts. Then let them read. Let their tongues run naked into books. Let their tongues run naked into books means let them read. How can somebody's tongue run naked when somebody reads? Let them read the books which are white and green leaves. So let them read from the books or let them read from the nature. White books are the books which you people have and green are the ones which is which is offered by nature. Let them read from books or from the nature. History theirs whose language is a sun. Let them read as much as they want, maybe from nature or maybe from the books, because only those people are able to do something worthwhile whose language is a sun. Those who have been embellished with knowledge, wisdom, and warmth of love. Sun is symbolic of, number one, light of knowledge. Sun is symbolic of warmth of love. So only those children can create history. Those who have been embellished with knowledge, love, and wisdom. So let them read. And how will they be able to read? When they will explore the world. When they will explore the world of nature, and when they will explore the world of books also. So, but don't hand them over the books only first. First, let them run naked upon the green fields. Let them enjoy upon the deserts. Let them read, explore the world. Let them read from books and let them read from the nature. Because only those people who are able to create history are the ones who have the opportunity to get love, knowledge, and wisdom. From where do I get the words love, knowledge, and wisdom? From the word sun. What's the language of sun? The language of sun is love, warmth, and wisdom. Is that clear? So let these children explore the world. Let them have the freedom. The very first thing to be given to these children is freedom. Because in the slums, they have been confined. They are living there in the cramped holes. They are living a life of confinement. They are hungry. So first of all, remove the slums and let them explore the world. Let them run upon green fields or upon the gold sands. And then let them explore the books. Maybe literary books or maybe the books of nature. Only those people who are able to create history are the ones who have been adorned with knowledge, wisdom, or love. Is that clear? So that's how the poem ends. So today we have finished the poem, children. And it was, I won't say like it's very difficult, but yes, it needs attention. So you people, there are still so many other poetic devices which we can discuss right now. Let's see. So the poem starts with the far, far from gusty waves. Children, today I'll send you the key of the answer sheets because right now the time is running out. Otherwise, I had planned to discuss the questions of the test which were there yesterday. Many children have not attempted the test. So you people attempt the test and see what the answers are. And today I might send the key. If not today, then we will discuss the test in the other class. But the main thing is that you people go through the answer keys and all the answers are correct. One child was telling me to review the options. All the options are correct. Maybe you have some other option in your mind, but whatever the options are there, you have to seek the answer out of that. Okay, so the all options are correct, you find out. Alliteration is where you are, where one consonant word is, sound is repeated. Okay, children, time is almost over. Revise this poem. And in the next class, we will be doing the next poem, Keeping Quiet. So do this poem thoroughly. So thank you. Somebody please send me the screenshot of the attendance.